my, that the Lord of all the earth would care to know my name, would care to feel my hurt. Who am I that the bright and morning star would choose to light the way for my ever wandering heart? Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly
fading. Boston this week, I think it was Brockton. Dave, turn me down just a touch, please. In one of the small stores there, Brockton had this sign out that said, "Welcome to Western New York in our seasons. Monday, winter. Tuesday, spring. Wednesday, summer. And Thursday, fall." So we've had it all this week. And we're glad to have you with us. As we open up this morning, I've been reading through Job. I know the ladies have been going through Job as well the last couple weeks. I'm going to just read a couple verses from the book of Job as we begin our worship service. This is God talking to Job and reminding Job of who God is and who Job is and the relationship that should be there, because that plays a role in what we've been talking about last week and for the next couple weeks when we talk about stewardship. So just a couple verses from Job. God begins by saying this: "Dress for action like a man." In other words, put your pants on, boy, we gotta talk. That's how I would probably say that. "Dress for action like a man, I will question you, and you make it known to me. Where were you when I laid the foundation of the earth? Tell me if you have understanding. Who determined its measurements? Surely you know. Or who stretched the line upon it? On what were its bases sunk? Or who laid its cornerstone? When the morning stars sang together and all the sons of God shouted for joy. Have you commanded the morning since your days began? Caused the dawn to know its place? Have the gates of death been revealed to you? Or have you seen the gates of deep darkness? Have you comprehended the expanse of the earth? Where is the way to the dwelling of light? Where is the place of darkness? What is the way to the place where light is distributed? Or where the east wind is scattered upon the earth? Can you bind the chains of the pleiads or loosen the cords of Orion? Do you know the ordinances of the heavens? Can you establish the rule on the earth? Can you lift up your voice to the clouds that a flood of waters may cover you? Can you send forth lightnings that they may go and say to you, 'Here we are'? Who has put wisdom in the inward parts or given understanding to the mind? Who can number the clouds by wisdom? Who can tilt the water skins of the heavens when the dust runs into a mass and the clods stick fast together?" And then God keeps going. And then Job says this in chapter 40, "Behold, I am small. What shall I answer you? I lay my hand on my mouth. I have spoken once and I will not answer. Twice, but I will proceed no further." Job says, "Yup, you're God. I'm not. I got it." You think the conversation might end there? But then God says, "Oh, hold up. Dress for action like a man." In other words, we're not done yet, Job. Let's make sure you know who you are and who I as God am. And that's where we have to be. We're coming into God's house. We're here to see each other. We're here to see friends and meet new people and family that we love. But above all, we are here to worship God. And so we're going to dress for action like men and women and kids. And we're going to worship the God who is all-powerful, who is all-knowing, and thankfully loves us. Let's just go into prayers and begin. Gracious Lord, Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you so much that in your power, you who could have just wiped us out at any time because of our sin chose to die on the cross, so that we might know you, so that we who were far away could be brought near. God, I just pray for our service this morning. Lord, for the other churches in town and around this county that are worshiping you this morning, that you would be glorified above all, that our agendas would be set to the side, that our distractions would be taken care of, that we would really see you for who you are. God, be glorified in what we say, what we do, how we sing, how we give. May we be reminded not only of your love for us, but who
thank you. deserve death place, Lord. Grant that you give us that power to say no to ourselves and to say yes to you. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Have you seen? I don't know if you've caught the focus, the theme of today, that goes right along with this theme of stewardship. We started this series last week on stewardship. We're going to try to get through some of it today, and then you know what? You get 2 weeks off from me. Thank you for no amens. Tim Mosier is going to be sharing the next two Sundays with us. Kelly and I are taking the kids to Chicago. We'll probably bring them all back. Hopefully they'll bring me back. We're going down there for a week, just a vacation. Maybe catch up with some friends. My mom's coming out to visit us as well. So we're looking forward to that. So be in prayer for Chicago. I mean, for us, as we go to Chicago. And we're just looking forward to getting a little rest. And I know Tim is going to take care of you guys and just do well. But be in prayer for him, too, as he prepares. Because y'all are kind of scared. Just going to lay that out there. We started talking about stewardship. And we've started discussing kind of four key principles that help us to understand what stewardship is and why we do it. And let's kind of go through some of our definitions that we talked about last week. First of all, we define a steward as a person who manages another person's property or affairs. In other words, a steward is someone who has been given responsibility to take care of something that doesn't belong to them. They don't become the owners, they're the stewards, they're the managers. That's the key point that we have to keep in our minds throughout this. The steward is not the owner. The owner owns, the steward manages. All right? Keep that in your mind. Now we looked at the whole purpose of stewardship in 1 Peter chapter 4, specifically verses 7 through 11. In that passage, we see that God has given each of us gifts. The original context, the main context there is spiritual gifts. But this applies to the physical things that we have, our time, our talents, and our treasures. All of those things that we have been given as stewards, we are to manage for two reasons. Number one, to better serve others. This church, in many ways, is phenomenal in the fact that we see somebody who's hurting, and one of the first things that I hear is, what can I do to help them? Whether it's go visit, whether it's go take care of a physical need, whether it's just write a check. You guys are awesome about that. We see each other as family. Even though we don't always get along, because we are family, we love each other. God gives us as a church, as individuals, gifts. And we're to use those to serve other people for the ultimate reason of giving God glory. Realize this, that the people in the community around us, they should be looking at First Baptist Church Mayville, and they should be saying a couple of things. First of all, what a handsome pastor they have. And secondly, they should be saying what a loving group of people they are. And thirdly, they should be saying, wow, they serve a great God. See, it shouldn't come back on us. It shouldn't come back on me, and it doesn't. It should all go to God. He should get all the glory. And so if we're good stewards of what we have, He will receive the glory. And you know what? He'll take care of us. We don't have to worry about it. God's going to control it. God's going to take care of it. We started in Genesis chapter 39. So take your Bibles. Go to Genesis 39. It's on page 22 in the Red Pew Bible, if that's what you're using. And we began looking at four principles of stewardship. We're looking at the life of Joseph, a man who, as we know, was so loved by his brothers that instead of killing them, they just sold him into slavery. He was bought by a man named Potiphar. Potiphar was a very important guy in the land of Egypt. He was working for the king. He had a lot of power. He had a lot of authority. He had a lot of money. And we started to look at this life of Joseph, and the first principle that we came to was this, the principle of ownership. Now remember, Joseph was bought as a slave, and he was brought in probably at the lowest rank of slave. Now, I don't know what that job task would be. But think about your work environment. I was in the factory, and I can tell you, when I brought a new person in, I had certain jobs that I trusted them with, and that was about it. And they weren't always pretty. And they weren't always clean. And they always kind of stunk just a little bit. But Joseph was brought in at the bottom. And Potiphar watched him as he continued to grow, and as he matured, and as Joseph did things, God blessed him. And so Joseph is kind of climbing the, I hate to call it the corporate ladder, although it sometimes feels like slavery, but he's climbing up the ladder. And eventually Potiphar looks at him and says, wow, you're doing such a good job. Everything that you do succeeds. I'm going to put you in charge. And so Joseph was promoted to the rank of overseer or steward of all that Potiphar owns. Now remember this. There was no verse that we looked at last week that said, and Joseph gained his freedom. Joseph was still a slave. He may have had a lot of authority, he may have had a lot of power, he may have had a lot of clout, but he was still a slave. Potiphar owned him. In the same way, the principle of ownership applies to us today in this. God owns all of creation. We talked last week how God created it. God sustains it. And because of Christ's work on the cross with his blood, he purchased us. As children of God, as children of the King, we are still servants. We still have a responsibility, and we need to know our role in God's kingdom, in God's plan. Joseph understood his role in the house of Potiphar. We, as believers, need to know our role. And the role that we're focusing on is just that of steward. If you want to be successful in your Christian life, let me make sure you hear this. If you want to be successful in your Christian life, and success in our Christian life is not how many trophies you have, it's not how many things you have in the driveway, it's not the size of your house. That's worldly success. Those are nice, but those are not the point. If you want to be successful in God's eyes, you become the good steward. You become the slave that honors God in everything that he does and says. Let's look at the next principle. This is where your notes are going to take off in your bulletin, so get your pencils ready. The second principle of stewardship builds directly on the first. If you have an issue with God being the owner and you being the steward, you're going to have an issue with this one. That's the principle of responsibility. Let's go to our text, Genesis chapter 39. Let's begin again in verse 1. Genesis 39, verse 1. Now Joseph had been brought down to Egypt. Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh, the captain of the guard, an Egyptian, had bought him from the Ishmaelites. That's the principle of ownership. Potiphar paid cash. Bought Joseph as a slave. Now we see the responsibility in verse 2. Joseph found favor in his sight and attended him, and he made him overseer of his house and put him in charge of all that he had. Potiphar, as the owner, took Joseph and made him the steward. You're going to manage the house. You're going to make sure that everything that needs to be done gets done. You're going to take care of the laundry. You're going to take care of the groceries. You're going to make sure the dog's got food and water. You're going to make sure that the cat's outside and never comes in the house because cats are good. You take care of all these things. And Joseph was given the resources to take care of those things. He was above other slaves. Now, we talked very briefly about this scenario that takes place between Joseph and Mrs. Potiphar. Pick it up down in the tail end of verse 6. Joseph was handsome and form in appearance, and after a time, his master's wife cast her eyes on Joseph and said, lie with me. But he refused and said to his master's wife, behold, because of me, my master has no concern about anything in the house. He has put everything that he has in my charge. He is not greater in this house than I am, nor has he kept back anything from me except yourself, because you are his wife. Joseph understands his role, but he also understood his responsibility. Everything in the house was his. He was responsible. Joseph realized he could have done just about anything, and as long as it didn't cost Potiphar money or pain, he would get away with it. When I was in management, I always told my employees, when the pain of having you becomes more than the pain of replacing you, you have a job. Joseph was in that. He could have done anything. Mrs. Potiphar comes, does the little wink-wink, tosses the hair to the side, and says, "How you doing?" And Joseph says, "No. I can't do this. Potiphar's given me everything. He's given me control of everything. But you know what? You are hands-off. You are his wife. I can't do that." I want you to put something here in Genesis. I want you to go to the book of Matthew. Go to the right until you hit red. And then Matthew, Mark, Luke, John will be that first one. Matthew chapter 25. It's on page 524 in your pew Bible. I've got two great texts that help us learn these principles. So I'm going to kind of give you both of them. We're going to flip back and forth between those two. Genesis 39, Matthew 25. Matthew 25 picks up with a Christ telling a parable or a story with a purpose. And in this story, he is going to reference some talents, some individuals. And let's pick it up. Matthew chapter 25, verse 14. Again, this is Christ talking. "It will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted to them his property." All right, in that very verse, we have two principles. We have the principle of ownership. We have the man who's going on a journey. Probably this man is a very successful businessman. And he's probably going on a business trip. As the owner, he looks at his property. He says, "I'm going to be away for a while. I'm going to entrust or give responsibility to certain of my servants." Verse 15. He calls three of his servants. "To one he gave 5 talents. To another 2, to another 1, to each according to his ability. Then he went away." You know, as a kid, if my dad or someone would preach on this passage, I'd say, "Man, that'd be cool to have 5 talents. Let's see, I can sing, I can play the guitar, basketball is a talent, so you like to do that." That's not what we're talking about. A talent is a unit of measure, it's weight. Usually it's referring to silver or gold. To one steward, he gives 5 talents. There's some debate over how much a talent of gold would be worth, but it's somewhere between, are you ready for this, 9 and 20 years worth of wages. That's a lot of cash. This is not a small little sum. It's not like me to my boys, "Oh, you're going to Walmart? Here's $1 for you. Here's $1 for you. Don't spend it all in one place." This man is unloading some serious cash on these three servants. One receives 5 talents, one receives 2, and one receives 3. And I want you to notice in verse 15, "to each according to his ability." He looked at his servants, he picked the top 3, and he said, "You know what? You are best suited to handle these 5 talents. You are best suited to handle these 2 talents. And you are best suited to handle 1 talent. Now the one guy, he might look at the 5 guys and say, "What's up with that?" But you know, that's kind of looking like, "Well, you've got 5 armored cars full of cash. I only got 1. I'll take the 1. He still had a lot of money to deal with. All right, back into our text, Matthew, verse 16. He who had received the 5 talents went at once, traded with them, and made 5 talents more. So also he who had the 2 talents made 2 talents more, but he who had received the 1 talent went and dug in the ground and hid his master's money. Each servant was given these talents, and each servant understood the responsibility, the expectation that the master had. They looked at this money and they said, "Oh, this isn't a Christmas bonus. This isn't like, you know, my 401k contribution that I get at the end of the year. This isn't profit sharing. This isn't mine. This is still the master's money. He may have given it to me, but there's a clear expectation." And we see the two of them had a pretty wise investment strategy because it paid off. It doubled their money. The third guy, his strategy was a little questionable. He dug a hole in the ground and buried the money. We'll see how well that pays off. Let's talk about this principle of responsibility in our life today, because we are stewards. We are not owners. That means that we are responsible to somebody. I hate that word, responsible. It's like a lot of work. But we're responsible. And we can go a number of different passages, but we're just going to think about Genesis chapter 1. Genesis chapter 1, verses 26 to 28. Lays out for us our role in creation. Genesis 1:26 begins day 6 of creation. God is getting ready to make man. And listen to what he says. God said this in verse 26. Let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, the birds of the heavens, the livestock, over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God he created them. Male and female he created them. And God blessed them. God said to them, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. Subdue it and have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens and over every living thing that moves on the earth. Two times in that text we see this phrase, this word, have dominion. You know what I think of when I think of dominion? I think of domination. I think of, you know, when my arch rival comes to town, let's see, when the Patriots show up in town, what do we want our Bills to do? We want them to kill them, dominate them, destroy them, and then go after their cheerleaders and take them out too. What normally happens? Not that. It's getting better. There's hope. When the Green Bay Packers come to Soldier Field, yeah, we tend to run and hide, so I guess that's not a good example. We think of dominion or domination as this like annihilation. We're going to own it. We're going to control it. We're going to blow out our competition, and it's going to be ours. God is not telling Adam to go annihilate creation. That word dominion in Hebrew means to rule over or to reign. You know what it's talking about? It's stewardship. It's talking about responsibility. Our job isn't to dominate and destroy. Our job is to nurture and to grow. We're going to talk about stewardship of the earth in a couple weeks as part of our stewardship series. But we've got to understand there's another side to this domination. We are called to be stewards. And not, you know, mediocre stewards. We're called to be good stewards of what God has given to us. God expected that from the very beginning. Let's move on to the third principle, and that is the principle of accountability. The principle of accountability. Back in our passage in Genesis 39, it's clear that Joseph understands that he's accountable both to Potiphar and to God. Look at verse 9. This is Joseph talking to Mrs. Potiphar. He says this, he's not greater, speaking of his boss Potiphar. Potiphar is not greater in this house than I am, nor has he kept anything back from me except yourself, because you are his wife. And here's the key phrase. How then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God? Joseph had ultimate authority in that house, as long as he stayed within his realm of responsibility. And if he stepped out of that, he knew he was going to be in trouble. And so he says to Mrs. Potiphar, no, I can't do that. It would be a great and wicked thing to do. And notice, there's a little bit of accountability to Potiphar, but there's a great amount of accountability to God. Joseph knew, yeah, he's going to answer to Potiphar, but he's also going to answer to God for his actions. Back in Matthew, we see the same principle in play. In verse 19 in Matthew 25, the master comes home and he calls his servants together. He says, all right, let's settle our accounts. Verse 19, after a long time, the master of those servants came and settled accounts with them. He who had received the 5 talents came forward, bringing 5 talents more. Say, master, you delivered to me 5 talents. Here I have made 5 more. His master said to him, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a little, I will set you over much. Enter into the joy of your master. Verse 22, he who had the two talents came forward, saying, Master, you delivered to me two talents. Here, I've made two talents more. His master said to him, Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over little. I will set you over much. Enter into the joy of your master. Can you imagine what it's like? Boss is gone for a while. I was number two in factories for years and years and years. It was really nice when the boss came back and things had gone smoothly. And you didn't have to tell him bad news. That's what the servants are up to. Boss comes home. First servant says, Yeah, you gave me five talents. Here's five more. Second servant comes out. You gave me two. I've got two more. Yay, me. Good servant. And notice how the boss responds. The master says, Well done. Well done, my good and faithful servant. You've been good in little things. I'm going to give you more responsibility. I'm going to give you more authority. I'm going to give you more of those trophies that you chase after. That's an awesome thing. They knew that they were going to be accountable. Joseph knew that he was going to be accountable to the master. And let me tell you something. We are accountable to God. We are going to one day stand before our Creator. And we're going to give an account for what we have done in this life. Two verses, Romans chapter 14 says this, Why do you pass judgment on your brother? Why do you despise your brother? We will all stand before the judgment seat of God, and each of us will give an account of himself. 2 Corinthians 5:10, we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ so that each one may receive what is due for what he has done in the body, whether good or evil. Let me tell you something. We love to go to that book of Revelation, and there's that verse that says God will wipe away all our tears and all the hurts and all the regrets, right? I love that verse. Guess what? That happens after we stand before God and give account. I think there's going to be a lot of tears from this guy especially. I mean, I cry enough up here. Imagine when my whole life gets laid out and God looks at me and says, Man, look at all the things that I gave you, all the opportunities I gave you, and you didn't do anything with it. You know what? I'm going to be crying. I don't know how it's all going to play out. I hope you're not there to witness that. But I'm going to face God. Just as Joseph faced his master, just as these servants here, Matthew, faced their master, we are all going to stand before our Creator, and there's going to be some accounting that takes place. That's kind of a scary thing. It's not a judgment of life and death, hell and heaven. But it is a judgment. And with accountability, guess what comes? Consequence. That's our last principle, the principle of consequence. We often look at the word consequence and we think of negative, right? If I do something wrong, the consequence is going to be bad. We never think of the word consequence like if I do something good, I get a reward. I get a cookie. Like cookies. That word consequence is a neutral word. It just simply means an event that happens because something else happens. If I'm good and I eat my veggies, which you know doesn't show up very often in our house, I can eat a cookie. That's a good consequence. We're accountable to God. Guess what? There's a consequence. Let's look at this. Two of the servants in Matthew were faithful, and they received rewards. Well done, good and faithful servant. You're faithful in a little. Here's more. We didn't talk about that third servant, though, did we? Look down to verse 24. He also, who had received the one talent, came forward, saying, Master, I knew you to be a hard man, reaping where you did not sow, gathering where you scattered your seed. So I was afraid. And I went and hid your talent in the ground. Here you have what is yours. I've been in business meetings where the boss is gone and he comes back and you know he gets all of his execs together. And I hated to be like the first one. But I really hate being the last one because, you know what, I was one of the salesmen. You know how they lie. Sorry if you're a salesman, I'm being offended. The salesman, oh, we did this and we reached this target, we brought in this new customer, and engineering, oh, we completed this project and we did this. And Well, production, we got the orders out on time, but we had some problems or some quality issues. What? Everybody else did so good. Why can't you be like that? The two servants go up and say, you gave me five, here's five more. You gave me two, here's two more. Here's the one you gave me. Not very pleasurable to be in. Look at verse 26, it's the master's response. The master answers and says, you wicked and slothful servant. I'm so glad my boss never called me that. He may have just gone out loud. You wicked and slothful servant, you knew that I reap where I've not sown, gather where I scattered no seed. Then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers. Then by coming, I should have at least received interest. So take the talent from him and give it to him who has the 10. Two servants were faithful. They received the reward. The one servant was unfaithful. He received punishment. It's not just bad enough that you're embarrassed. You know, here's the one little thing I had that didn't change. He was punished. He lost that talent, that responsibility, that opportunity, gone. It was given to someone else. He received punishment. Now, I want you to understand what we're talking about. I don't think that this steward was punished because, and make sure you understand this, he wasn't good at being a steward. He wasn't punished because he didn't understand his responsibility. The text indicates very clearly, they all knew, here's your talents, go make me more money. Trust me, when your boss gives you something, it's not for your self-enjoyment usually, it's to make money for the company. He understood his responsibility. And it's not that he was unable to do it. Remember what, I think it was verse 16 said, the master gave the talents to them, each according to their ability. The master didn't come and say, hey, I want you to do something. I know you can't do it. You're probably going to fail, but have at it. He gave him a task that was well within his wheelhouse. He was able to do it. This servant was punished because he failed to try. He didn't put the effort out. He said, well, I know you're a harsh man. And I know that you gather where you haven't sown seed. In other words, you can, you know, it's like hostile takeovers in the business world. You reap from other people's work. And I was afraid that I would disappoint you. So I just didn't even try. There's times that I look at what God has called me to do. And you know what? I fall into that realm of the third servant. Well, God, I know you're a just God and you're righteous and you have expectations, and I just don't think I'm capable of doing what you've called me to do. And so, why bother? I'm not even going to try. That's a sin. Let me tell you flat out, that is a sin. God gives us our talents according to our abilities. And I've seen God take a person's abilities and honestly change them over the course of his life. You know what? 20 years ago, when I kind of wrestled a little bit with this whole preaching thing, there was no way I could stand up in front of four or five people, let alone a congregation, and share anything. My high school speech class was me, my two best friends, and another guy. And you know what? I barely passed it because I was nervous. I was scared to death to talk to people. Now you can't get me to shut up. Look at verse 29 and Matthew 25. We have this parable ends with a very serious warning. To everyone who has will more be given. He will have an abundance. But the one who has not, even what he has will be taken away. Verse 30, cast the worthless servant into the outer darkness. In that place there will be weeping, gnashing of teeth. That verse 30 is a little scary, isn't it? Those same phrases are used to talk about hell. Now, understand, I'm a firm believer in what we call eternal security. God is strong enough and capable enough to save me. He is strong enough and capable enough to keep me saved. Because it's not about what I do. About what he did for me on the cross. So I don't think this servant was cast into hell, but he was certainly cast out. And you know what? Darkness and weeping and gnashing of teeth, that doesn't sound like any place I would be. I don't want to deal with those things. I want to be in the presence of the master. I want joy. I want responsibility. I want a purpose in life. So according to these verses, if you are a faithful steward, you're going to see positive consequences happen. Now again, I think it was Saturday. I was having trouble sleeping Saturday morning. And my TV was on, and I ran across that same, I don't know why we leave it on this channel, but in the middle of the night we have these TV preachers on. And it's the old, if you just plant a seed of $1,000, God's going to return to you $10,000. That's not what this parable is saying. Okay? Make sure you understand it. You may be a giver, and you may give $1,000 to the work of God. That does not mean that God is required to send you $10,000. He may. He may not. He may bless you another way. What this is saying is that if you are a faithful steward, God is going to bless you. Now, I've watched people who have the spiritual gift of giving. And I've watched how it's an amazing thing. They give a little, and God gives them a little bit more back. And they look at that, and they do kind of the opposite of what I do. Remember, I told you last week, I'm not real good at the stewardship thing, right? I'm still working on this. But they get this little extra back, and you and their thought is, wow, I can give more. My first thought is, ooh, I can get more chocolate. But that guy with the gift of giving said, I can give more to God now. And so he does, and then God brings more into his life. But it's not always money. It could be land, it could be property, it could be opportunities. What about being a faithful steward of the opportunities that we're given to spread the gospel? You know what? If you go and tell one person, guess what? Your mind is already focused on telling somebody else. And you go, God brings that person into your life. And now your stewardship, your faithful stewardship is rewarded by having more opportunities. And then you take those opportunities and you just get on fire. Faithful stewards receive rewards. And on the other side of the coin, unfaithful stewards, they receive negative consequences. There is punishment that comes. You know, too many times we look at stewardship as like a good thing to do, but if we don't do it, it's kind of gray. Let me just throw that idea out now. Failure to be a good steward is a sin. And we know that sin has consequences. We know that sin brings punishment. Sin breaks fellowship with God. Faithfulness, reward. Unfaithfulness, punishment. Let's go back to Genesis 39. Let's not leave poor Joseph there in trouble with Mrs. Potiphar. In the passage, we see Potiphar's wife making advances at Joseph, and Joseph says, no, I can't do this. And it goes on, day after day after day. And then one day, poor Joe ends up in a part of the house with just Mrs. Potiphar. She comes up to him. She grabs him by the shirt. She says, hey, now's our opportunity. And Joseph says, no. And she keeps pushing. And eventually he just runs, leaving his coat behind. Mrs. Potiphar is so upset, she makes up a lie. She begins to tell the servants how Joseph tried to rape her. When Mr. Potiphar comes home, she tells him the same story. Joseph came into me while you're gone. Your servant came into me while you were gone and tried to take advantage of me. And she lies to Mr. Potiphar. And in verse 19, we read this. As soon as his master Potiphar heard the words that his wife spoke to him, this is the way your servant treated me. His anger was kindled, and Joseph's master took him, put him in the prison, the place where the king's prisoners were confined, and he was there in prison. Joseph was faithful, but what happened? I would not call being stuck in prison a positive consequence. Think about this. Joseph was a good and faithful servant. Potiphar had complete trust in this man over everything, knowing that he would do the right thing. But then Mrs. Potiphar tells the lie. Mr. Potiphar becomes angry, throws Joseph in jail. Not what I'd call a positive response. And I'll be honest, not what I would call a great motivator for me to be a good steward. I mean, think about it. If I'm a good steward and I still have a 50-50 shot of good versus bad, I'm not sure those odds are really in my favor. I may not be so willing to do it. The immediate consequence of faithfulness was negative. But think about how the book of Genesis ends. Let's think about the rest of Joseph's life. He's there in prison. And the butler, the baker, the king get thrown into prison as well because they burnt the toast and, you know, whatever. They have a dream. Joseph is able to interpret it. One of them dies. One of them gets back out of jail. The butler is there. And Joseph says, listen, when you get to the Pharaoh, remember me. Tell him I'm in here wrong. This isn't right. This is unjust. And the guy gets back into the court and totally forgets about Joseph. Another negative. But one day Pharaoh has a couple of dreams that just really mess him up. As he's working through this, that poor guy who was in jail, Joseph remembers, I know a God. If Joseph hadn't been in prison, he never would have interpreted those dreams of the butler and the baker. He would never have had the opportunity to stand before Pharaoh and interpret Pharaoh's dream through the help of God. And after he did that, Pharaoh makes Joseph the chief steward of all the land. Now Joseph isn't a slave. He's a free man. He's an important man with great authority. He is a man with responsibility, and he knows his place. He knows his role in the kingdom. Keep going on, tailoring to Genesis, we find that there's a famine in the land. And because of Joseph's faithfulness in the prison, as a slave, and then to Pharaoh as a free man, he ends up saving not only the nation of Egypt, he ends up saving his family. See, the long-term consequences of his faithfulness were very, very positive. You know, we struggle with this part of stewardship. I look at my checkbook and I say, I really don't have that much. I look at my calendar and I say, I really don't have that much. I look at myself and I say, I'm really not that much. And so if I give to God, I'm going to miss out on something else. And God says, listen, give to me anyway. Time, talents, treasure. Give to me. I'll take care of you. And we struggle when, you know what, we write that check or we put that appointment on our calendar, we show up and we do the ministry, we do the work, and nothing happens. Our life isn't changed in some great way, and we struggle. It's like, God, you paying attention here? I stepped out in faith, and nothing happens. You think Joseph felt going back to prison? God, I'm being faithful. I'm doing exactly what you told me to do. And I'm being punished for this? This isn't right. This doesn't make sense. In our humanness, we don't get it. I don't understand my little Joshua. Sitting in that hospital bed. He hasn't even had a chance to be faithful. But the long-term consequences is what I have to do. See, God looks at the big picture. We're so focused on, you know, our little time slot on my calendar, that 15-minute window, and God says, 15 minutes, man? I'm talking eternity. I'm talking big picture. Because Joseph was faithful in the little, he was able to save many lives, the nation of Israel. Because servants were faithful, they were able to receive those rewards. And let me promise you this, if we're faithful to God, he will be faithful to us. I have no doubt in my mind that these things that we look at as negative, they're just God working. And because he's the owner, and I'm not, I have to trust him. And so we have four principles of stewardship. First one is the principle of ownership. God is God, I am not. He is the creator, I am the creation. He is the sustainer, it is only because he lets me breathe, I breathe. He is the owner. I am the steward. I have to have that right to begin. The second one, the principle of responsibility. Because God is the owner, I'm responsible to him. Too many times, this is where we flip things, isn't it? Okay, God, you're the creator, but you know what? This is my life, and I want to do things my way, so here's the plan. You just do it. And then we get disappointed when God doesn't do it. You know what the problem is? and we're the steward. The steward doesn't tell the owner what to do. We have to keep that relationship right. We have to realize we are responsible to him, and with responsibility comes accountability. There's going to be a day when we stand before God. You know what I really want to hear? Good job, man. Well done. That's what I'm looking for. Will there be tears? Oh, you bet. We can do things through the grace of God to be accountable and to be rewarded at the end. And then we have that principal consequence. There will be rewards. There will be punishments. There is going to be positive and negative things for how well we have managed the things that God has given to us. So let's talk about application for just a minute. We ended last week with this question. Do you see yourself as the steward or as the owner? This is really the foundation. This is the baseline principle that we've got to deal with. If I see myself as God, I'm in for a disappointment. I barely pass as a man, let alone as God. Anytime I take God off the throne and put myself there, I'm violating the principles that we've talked about. It's not going to happen. We're not going to be successful as Christians if we continue to put ourselves on the throne. So where are you today? Think about this. What do you need to change in order to become a faithful steward? Maybe it's this owner-steward role thing. We've got to know our role. We've got to know what we're supposed to do. Maybe it's not that. Yeah, you know God's creator, and you're looking at yourself saying, I have nothing to offer God. I'm just a measly little grunt. What can I do? Well, just as the master in Matthew 25 gave to each of his servants according to their abilities, God has given each and every one of us as believers spiritual gifts and talents. And the expectation is very clear. We're responsible. We're going to be accountable. I need to use those things. It may not be much. You know, we got a couple of guys sitting in the back of the room. They're going to be mad at me for doing this. If things go bright during the service, you don't even think about Josh and Danny and then Tim's back there for you. You don't think about them because you know what? The noise isn't going crazy. The slides are showing up as they should. Is that hard to push a button? Danny thought so this morning because he's learning new software. But is it really that hard to push a button at the right time? No, but you know what? They're using the abilities and the gifts that God gave them. Is it a small service type of thing? Absolutely. Is it important? Yeah. It really is because it leads us into worship. It's not just about the guys who are up front. Every person has something that they can do. Every person has some gift that God has given to them in order to do it. You just need to change something in your life so that you are becoming that faithful steward. Maybe it's an action you need to take. Maybe it's an attitude that you need to change. But whatever it is, change it. Make the changes you need to make in your life so that you are being a faithful steward. And then, does the stewardship, does the things you do, you know what, I could stand up here and brag about, oh, I'm on YouTube and I'm on cable access. Look at that. I can do all of these things. I can be very successful because I'm able to do it. But you know what? I'm glorifying myself. It's about me. That is not stewardship. Stewardship is about serving others and glorifying God. So what's your motivation? Boils down to this. We are called to be stewards of everything that God has given to us. And you know what we have to do? You ready for the four-letter word we all hate? We have to obey. Yeah, I know. I hate that word too. Yes, you matter. If we are unwilling to obey God's commands, we're not going to be happy. We're not going to be content. You know, you can have a lot of trophies in this world. You can have the house and the boat and the cars and the outward signs of success. But all those things perish. The cars get wrapped around trees. The boats sink into the lake. Snowmobiles go through the water and the ice. And you know what? That trophy husband you married, it gets uglier and uglier as it goes. Sorry, babe.
for the things that we do for God, the stewardship that we manage in our lives, it's investments in eternity. Not just for ourselves, but for each other. And I pray that we will all be able to stand before God and have Him look at us and not say, you wicked and slothful servants. But that we obey Him. And we stand before Him and He says, well done. Well done, my good and faithful servants. Enter into the joy of your Master. Let's pray. Gracious Lord, Heavenly Father. I really do want to be a good steward. I really do want to please you in my life and my actions. And yet, God, so many times I get focused on me. What can I do? How can I do this big thing that I so often think is what your will is? The reality is you're just calling me to obey. God, be with this church. Be with the churches in this community that we would be stewards of what you've given us. We think of ourselves as just this small little blip on the map. What can we do to reach this world? Well, when we follow you, when we obey you, when we use the gifts and the talents and the treasures that you've given to us, God, we can change the world, not through our strength, not through our minds, but through yours. So God, I ask that you would give us a steward's heart, that we would desire, we would have a passion to serve you in all that we do. We ask this in Jesus' name.